Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Before we begin, we are joined today by Gillian Mackay, who is attending the meeting as a substitute member in Ross Greer's absence at another committee. I invite Gillian to declare any relevant interests. Gillian.
No relevant interest, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. The first item on our public agenda today is an evidence session with the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on the Budget Scotland Act 2023 Amendment Regulations 2024. Draft. Mr. Arthur is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Scott Mackay, Head of Finance Coordination, and Craig Maidment, Senior Finance Manager. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Good morning, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the Committee. As the Committee will be aware, we continue to face challenging economic circumstances. Continued inflationary pressures, particularly around public sector pay, have put real pressure on the Scottish budget over the course of the financial year. Despite some improvement in the overall funding position since the autumn budget revision, managing the impact of pay deals within the overall position has been challenging. Reprioritisation of budgets has been necessary due to continued inflationary pressures, including on public sector pay, and to support priority areas such as the ongoing funding for Ukrainian displaced people. In her letter to the committee in November, ahead of the UK autumn fiscal event, the Deputy First Minister set out the tough choices that the Scottish Government has been required to make to ensure that we can achieve a balanced budget. The spring budget revision shows the outcome of those tough choices being actioned. The spring budget revision provides the final opportunity to formally amend the Scottish budget for 2023-24 and contains the usual four categories of changes. The net funding changes increase the budget by £546.8 million. These changes include providing £750.8 million to health to support services, fund pay rises and support as it continues to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic, £134 million to police and fire pensions, £51.8 million net to social security benefit expenditure and £41.2 million to the Ukrainian resettlement. To help fund these priority areas, it has been necessary to reprioritise budgets in the manner the Deputy First Minister outlined. The technical, Whitehall and internal transfers are presented in the document in the usual way. There are some extremely large technical adjustments included within the spring budget revision. These include a £3.1 billion decrease in the AME budget requirement for NHS and teachers' pensions, and a £735 million increase in the non-cash budget cover required for student loans. I know from our previous discussions that the committee is aware that these changes do not impact the Scottish Government's discretionary spending power. These adjustments reflect latest estimates and are used to set the final budgets that outturn is reported against in the annual accounts. These are required to limit material differences being reported against the budget totals in the accounts and try to avoid the confusion around underspends that has emerged in previous discussions in Parliament. The supporting document to the spring budget revision and the finance update prepared by my officials provide further background on the net changes, as well as updates on information requested by the committee. And on that, convener, I will conclude.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And in time-honoured fashion, we'll go through some of these changes to try and get further information and elaboration on how decisions have been made and what the impact will be. So I think the first one probably is, I'll start off with NHS Recovery Health and Social Care Portfolio. The additional funding includes £514 million of resource and £235 million of capital. But a wee bit coy about what that is going to be spent or invested in, so I wonder if you can give us a wee bit more information.
Well, as I touched on in my opening remarks, there is no part of the public sector that has been immune to the significant pressures we have seen arising from inflation, the general cost of living crisis conditions that have been impacting every aspect of society. So this additional funding for health is there to support the in-year position. This is, of course, for within this financial year, and it is to support our health services in addressing these pressures in year. So, for example, that includes elements around public sector pay, as was touched on in my earlier remarks.
Indeed, but the 235 million of capital interests me, because as we know there's been a kind of 2-year moratorium we hear in terms of capital, new capital projects in the NHS. Of course there's still money being spent in terms of care and maintenance, but I'm just wondering, this 235 million, what does that represent as a share of the kind of capital allocated to the NHS, and what's it being invested in?
Well, in terms of what it's been invested in, it will cover a range of areas, as you would imagine, of capital expenditure. As I've touched on a moment ago, and I think this is more broadly reflected across the autumn budget revision, we are operating in an environment where capital budgets are under significant pressure. And of course, the position that we're moving into in the next financial year is compounded by the reduction over the medium term and the capital that we will receive from the UK government. With regards to the capital position in relation to the overall NHS capital allocation, so Craig, do you have these figures at hand? Scott?
I don't have that exact figure to hand. I would have to follow up.
The question specifically was with regards to what does the £235 million represent as a share of the overall capital allocation towards health?
If you think about it, Minister, sorry to interrupt, but the total capital budgeted spend will be £5.845 billion. So £235 million is quite a significant slice of that in one particular portfolio. So that's why I was quite intrigued as to you know, what that money is actually going to be spent on, you know?
Well, as I touched on, it will cover a range of capital expenditures across the health portfolio. And as we touched on, I recognise the interest in the capital position going forward. But this is to support the in-year position, recognising the range of pressures that the health portfolio is facing. So all I can say is it's broadly supporting capital expenditure across the health portfolio.
Okay. It would be good to get further detail on that. The other thing as well is, given the pressures that you've talked about, there's £108.9 million that's been unallocated in terms of capital. So one would have thought that if you, if there was, given the pressures, that you would have tried to allocate, well, virtually all of it.
Well, with regards to unallocated funds, that ultimately arises from the fact that we do not have certainty over what our final position will be this year. There can be material movements up to the end and indeed beyond the end of the financial year. So that is just a reflection of the inherent uncertainty with regards to how our fiscal framework operates. Do you want to come in, Scott?
Yeah. I was just going to say we got some surprises at the supplementary estimate. In terms of additional funding, we've got additional capital funding where we'd been modelling on the basis of negative consequentials based on our discussions with Treasury. So, you know, in the run-up to the spring budget revision, we were anticipating less funding than actually materialised. So that's a key contributing factor to us having that position. And obviously you're well aware of the pressures in 24-25. We're, as the Minister says, we're still finalising the position for this year, but you know, should things come in on forecast, then we would have some additional capital carried forward through the reserve to subject to that final position.
And is this going to be fully allocated in 24-25 then?
Well,
are we going to end up a year from now with another situation where we've got £100 million unallocated?
Scott touched on, and if memory serves me correct, as he's referenced in the guide that we provided to the committee, when we have a scenario where, through the way in which the UK cycle of fiscal events operate, with supplementary estimates only being confirmed at the end of February, scenarios and situations can arise where we receive funding that was not anticipated. So we have to manage that funding now. Clearly, we still have to get towards to complete this financial year. But any funding that is not allocated and spent within this year would, of course, be carried forward to support the position in 24-25. And more broadly speaking, that is something that we have consistently been able to do, is to ensure that any funding that we do receive, discretionary funding, is spent in year, and if it is not spent in year, it is carried forward. We have not lost any discretionary spend as a consequence of late consequentials, and that speaks to the important role that the Scotland Reserve plays in allowing that flexibility.
Okay, well, thank you for that clarification. One of the issues that we've discussed at this committee is the long-term financial sustainability of the public finances, and we see that Social Security, the increase is £284.2 million on a budget which is already growing very dramatically. I'm just wondering if you can talk us through that and why there is such a huge differential between what was anticipated and what is now having to be spent.
Well,
of
course,
it's a man-led budget, but it just seems a huge difference.
Of course, the net position, when you look at the look at it in the round, is less than that. We monitor carefully the position on social security spend and are cognisant of the need for long-term sustainability. So we monitor that position very carefully. I'm conscious that we have provided some more up-to-date information, which we brought to bear in our understanding of the current position. Is that something that you're able to comment on, Scott?
Well, what I would add is obviously this is based on updated forecasts from the SFC and then subsequent information from the Social Security Policy Team on demand. And these are demand-led budgets. Now, clearly we established the policy position and the qualification criteria, and then there's a limit to the extent to which you can actively manage those budgets within those criteria. So it is demand-led, and we need to manage the movements in year. We have some flexibilities within the fiscal framework, some borrowing capability that is linked to helping us to smooth the management of volatility so we can borrow against forecast changes. But, you know, it's one of the challenges of managing a budget of that scale when it's demand-led is the level of volatility that we see.
Yeah, I mean, it's demand-led, but, I mean, there must have been a vague idea, rough idea, a pretty good idea of what it would be given the fact that it's not something that's been started from scratch. I mean, there's a baseline from the DWP, and there might be people on the fringes of that who don't maybe qualify under some of the DWP regulations but will qualify for some of the new benefits that the Scottish Government has introduced. It just seems quite a significant underestimation of what was required.
I mean, obviously it's a big number, but I think in the context of the, it's a relatively small percentage differences can be big figures. And obviously the team, the Social Security team, you know, are developing their modelling continually, but you do see volatility. It's a continual challenge within the narrow limits of the flexibilities that we have. Managing, £6 billion worth of social security expenditure that is demand led is within those limits is challenging.
Okay. The education skills portfolio is receiving an additional £54.1 million. The largest element of this relates to £29.8 million being provided to the Scottish Qualifications Authority to, and I quote, support its ongoing activities. What are these ongoing activities that weren't previously anticipated?
This reflects pay awards, appointee costs following the introduction of the curriculum for excellence and to ensure alignment with real living wage, inflation and other operational costs as well. So pay awards, inflation and other various operational costs.
Would it not be better just to say that then, rather than just ongoing activities, which is a bit vague? I mean, I think the point of this is to try and ascertain where money has gone, either up or down. And I think if that's just if we're just given that information, make life a lot easier than some ongoing activities. You're bound to get a question on something like that because it's so vague, and we're talking nearly £30 million. You know?
I appreciate that position, convener. It's something we'll take away.
I wonder if you can, Minister, talk me through the Transport Net Zero and Just Transition portfolio, because my understanding is we've been told, on one hand, that it's receiving additional funding of £81.6 million, the vast majority of this being provided as additional borrowing capacity for Scottish Water. But at the same time, the actual overall Scottish Government portfolio figures show a reduction from £4,307.8 million to £4,068.7 million, which is a 207, it's actually a decrease of nearly £240 million, about over 5% decrease. So I'm just wondering if you can talk us through that, because obviously those figures don't seem to add up to me.
Certainly there's areas where, for example, it's not been possible to deliver the spend in year. Example in Heaton's building programme. There's other elements where there has been work is still ongoing in business cases, for example, which has meant that money couldn't be spent in year. On the specific point around the Scottish Water borrowing, may I ask Scott to come in on that element?
Okay, thank you. Now, in Justice and Home Affairs, has had funding reductions of £65.5 million. Of this, £41 million relates to capital funding for the HMP Highland and HMP Glasgow projects, which will be reprofiled into future years. So, when you say reprofiled, you just mean delayed, don't you?
Well, in these areas, that just reflects the challenges within the construction sector on these particular capital projects, if they are to. These are macro factors that are not within our control. So we have to be able to respond to the economic environment we're in. Now, Scott, I was going to ask just Scott, because you'd asked a specific question around Scottish Water, convener. I was just going to ask. Mm-hmm.
So were you interested in the... I think the point... We're obviously trying to show the gross funding movements, so that's why we're showing increases and decreases rather than the net position. On Scottish Water specifically, there's a five-year regulatory period. We engage with Scottish Water on their capital requirements over that regulatory period and the borrowing necessary to support that, and then that is profiled, and where capacity allows, we can adjust that profile in response to the needs of Scottish Water. So it's part of a planned investment programme, and there's movements within that across the regulatory periods.
Okay. Now, in terms of the technical adjustments, I'm not going to go through all of those, but there is one there. The additional budget cover has been provided for private finance initiative projects in NHS recovery, health and social care, £48.1 million. And it says here, this technical change falls outside of UK budget limits, is provided to align the Scottish budget with accounting requirements. What does that really mean? What accounting requirements are we actually talking about?
Just again, this is obviously not something that impacts upon discretionary spend, but giving us technical aspect, I'll ask Scott to comment.
So there's a difference with the way some PPP projects are budgeted and accounted for, where it's off balance sheet in terms of budgeting. So we score in budgetary terms only the unitary payments, but in accounting terms, you recognise the full value of the underlying asset in the accounts. So what this budget adjustment is reflecting movements in those accounting values. So it needs to be shown so that we have a budgetary aggregate that reflects what we're going to show in the accounts in Scottish budgetary terms, but it doesn't impact on those Treasury budgets. So it's indicative of that difference between the budgeting for these off-balance sheet PFI projects and the accounting for them. Is that helpful?
It's certainly helpful to Michelle, because she's been nodding away. Yes, okay, thank you. Now, one of the The important aspects of the budget is, of course, the Verity House agreement and how the interaction there. And the budget, as part of the budget document, £1 billion of ring-fenced funding previously been held within portfolios was baselined into local government settlement. Mm-hmm. I know that's been welcomed in local government. We've actually got a breakdown of all that information here. But I'm just wondering how much remains ring-fenced.
Well, the elements that are ring-fenced will be set out as they routinely are. What I want to say is that we have that commitment through the Verity House agreement to establishing a fiscal framework with local government. That's work we are committed to seeing through and working at pace to deliver. So in terms of where we are within this process of baselining what we have arrived at for 24-25, represents a point on this journey, but I know there's an interest in Parliament, I know there's an interest in from this committee, and certainly from local government to continue discussions about what further progress we can make going forward.
Okay, and where do you anticipate that?
I wouldn't want to preempt the outcome of these discussions. Clearly it covers a range of different portfolio and ministerial interests.
But the direction of travel is to reduce ring fencing further. Would it be
what we've achieved so far. Mm-hmm. And I know there's a strong interest from local government to explore how we can take that further. And as part of that Verity House process and the commitment around the fiscal framework, we're committed to having that engagement in those discussions.
Okay, now in terms of supplementary estimates, I mean, Scott kind of touched on these earlier on. Additional funding is classed as expected from the UK government, but it's not clear why these are included if they're only expected as opposed to confirmed. I mean, I know there's a lot of exasperation in the Scottish government, and that sometimes the UK government will hint that money's coming and it might come and it might not come, etc., etc. So I just wonder if you can tell us when you decide to include or not include figures in these estimates.
Well, I think we provide some commentary on this within the guide that we've provided to the committee. There's informal information that can be shared at official level. There is engagement that would take place between the Deputy First Minister and the CST through the FISC forum. So these can provide opportunities, but as was touched on earlier in terms of what our earlier assumptions have been around capital and negative consequences, and that not ultimately being what prevailed, there is inherent in the process a degree of uncertainty. So this just reflects ultimately the way in which the wider UK fiscal framework operates. There is this process of supplementary estimates where we find out very late in the financial year what our final allocations from the UK government are going to be. And so what we are seeking to do is to provide as much information as possible to ensure that the Budget Act, as amended for the financial year, is as reflective of the position as we understand it. But of course, the position does not actually finalise until not just even at the end of the financial year, but beyond that as well. So it is challenging, and what we're seeking to do is to provide that balance. So I recognise that there are judgments that have to be made, but is that ultimately just reflective of the way in which the UK fiscal framework operates? Was there anything you were wanting to ask, Scott?
Yeah, I mean, it's a persistent timing issue. The supplementary estimate, has finalised, pretty late in recent years, and we need to complete the spring budget revision. We've got a lead time associated with that we need to hit. We need to reflect the funding changes within the document. We needed that to balance the position, and we engage obviously on a regular basis with Treasury officials. And we have some indication of a likely position that is what we've incorporated into the document. But as you'll see from the subsequent information, that did vary quite significantly from those indicative figures, particularly on resource.
Okay, so thanks very much. And before we move on, I just want to thank you for providing detail in terms of the reserves and the public corporations. That wasn't something the Finance Committee had detail on before. And it's interesting to note that there are, you know, that you've actually outlined the half a dozen corporations and where they actually stand as individually, and how that, you know, where they actually sit within the whole issue of public reserves. I mean, I had imagined there were dozens of these organisations all with pots of money, but I think it's quite good to see the clarification that there are indeed only half a dozen. Okay, right, we'll open up now with the first questions to come from Liz, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you. Minister, notwithstanding the difficulties with timescales and the uncertainties, which I think we all acknowledge as a Finance Committee, can I just take you back to the comments you mentioned in reply to the convener's question about the unallocated sums in the health budget, capital budget, that is. You were very clear that you gave a broad spectrum, that this was to do with a range of capital projects, but you didn't actually give us any details to what they are. The reason I'm asking is that obviously the public has seen in recent weeks that certain building capital building projects have been paused, and I just wonder if you could tell us exactly a bit more detail about what that money is being held back for.
Yeah, just to clarify, it's capital, it's not unallocated, but been allocated through the spring budget revision that you're referring to.
Indeed, but it's being held over.
Well, it's been allocated in year. This money is part of the spring budget revision for 23-24. No, as I say, it covers capital expenditure. So in terms of what would classify as capital expenditure, that will be wide-ranging within the health portfolio. These will be supporting the existing variety of work that would classify as capital expenditure within the health portfolio. I think in terms of providing a list of line by line of all of the various expenditure that's classed as capital expenditure within the health service, I can't provide you with that.
Yeah, I'm not asking for a full list, Minister. It's just that, you know, in terms of the public perception of this, they see that certain building projects have had to be stalled. And you know, if there is some unallocated money, I think the question in the mind of the public will be, you know, what's the reason behind that money not being spent when there's obviously a very considerable tightening in the public purse?
I think clearly we have, as I touched on earlier, we're going to have an exceptionally challenging set of circumstances around capital going forward over the medium term. That's something the committee appreciates, and that in itself forms the context in which the decisions around future capital projects, and not just in the health service but more widely, are considered. This of course relates to the current financial year, so it's in terms of the ongoing activity that is a part of the capital expenditure of the health service at this class today. So I can appreciate the matter around perception with this being allocated, but I think it's important to make that distinction between what is happening within this financial year and supporting that ongoing capital expenditure within the NHS, which I'm sure the committee appreciates will cover a range of areas, is something distinct from where we are looking in 24-25 going forward, and in the context of the capital constraints that we'll be operating under.
Now, I understand that, Minister, but I think it was you yourself who mentioned earlier that, you know, we always have this argument about an underspend. And there's not always a good understanding about that. In this specific case, I think there will be questions asked about that, because there is money there, which as yet has not been marked for any particular projects. And that's or at least the transparency about that is, shall we say, not entirely full. So that's the difficulty that we have when we're trying to explain that to the public.
I would just as well make a point that with regards to allocation, budgets at the outset allocate full amounts, but clearly there is developments as the year progresses. There can be underspends, there can be slippage, there can be targeted savings which can free additional capacity, and that applies obviously both to resource and capital, reflecting just the usual routine in-year budget management. And the challenges that we're facing, of course, were set out by the Deputy First Minister in the letter she sent to the committee in advance of the UK autumn fiscal event. So it's just important to make that distinction that we're not in a situation where budgets are being set with some sitting unallocated, but as they progress through the financial year, owing just to the dynamics of I've referred to, we will always seek to respond where resource or capital does become available to ensure that it is effectively allocated to support the in-year position across the public sector.
I'm sure it's a timescale issue. It's difficult in terms of increasing the transparency over how budgets work, just to make it very clear, you know, that if there are specific projects awaiting that money, that we know what they are. I think that's the key issue, because let's be honest, in recent years we've had a big argument about underspends at the end of the year, and it's not always clear exactly what the reason for that is. Can I just move on to the question about the revised fiscal framework, which has obviously increased the flexibility that the Scottish Government has when it comes to its borrowing powers. Has that had an important effect in helping you to address some of the constraints that you face?
I think one of the things that we, and I think again we refer to this within the guide that we provided for the committee, is the additional flexibility around the reserve is welcome. Now, I appreciate we're obviously operating in a situation right now where we're in a very challenging environment for the public finances, but as we highlight, that greater flexibility is something that will be, I think, of considerable value in future years. Of course, with now that growth that will happen in terms of the our capital borrowing powers, for example, that will of course have an effect over the medium to longer term, and that will, I think, over time increase our scope to borrow. We of course have to borrow sustainably with capital, but it will increase our scope over time to do.
And do you think that will give a little bit of greater certainty to the planning process for that capital spend in the future? I mean, is that going to be beneficial to the Scottish Government to work on that increased flexibility?
I think it certainly can be beneficial, but of course, capital availability of capital is only one element. There's many other factors, of course, which will determine the viability of capital projects. Recognised in recent years with all the challenges around supply chain shortages, inflation and pressures within the construction sector, that can all have an impact as well. So even just having the capital resource available in itself is not necessarily a guarantee that that any project for any organisation can progress at the pace that they would want. But broadly speaking, going forward, given that the challenge we have right now is a lack of capital, which is constraining what we want to do, these additional flexibilities are welcome. And I think as we see them grow over coming years, that will be of benefit.
Okay. And just one final question, if I may, Convener. When it comes to capital investment, I mean, obviously, one of the difficulties UK and for Scotland recently has been the fact that there has been real pressure on supply chains, and that there has been greater sense of inflation in these in the construction industry, for example, which has made things very difficult. Does the Scottish Government see that as easing a little bit in terms of planning for, you know, big projects on a capital basis in the future?
I think there certainly obviously has been changes compared to the position that we were in 2 years ago. But of course, these challenges persist, and we have having to contend with the higher costs and the challenges that come with that as a consequence of the period of high inflation that we've seen. And of course, inflation is still high by historic standards. So these present ongoing challenges as to the other factors that we've touched on. But what we're committed to doing is working within the limited flexibilities that we do have, is to ensure that we can work constructively and collaboratively to deliver on these capital projects. But we've had to set out very clearly the challenges that we're facing and what the consequences of those challenges are for the timescales of various projects.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Michelle, to follow by Michael.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and supporting staff. Just following up a point for that Liz Smith was making, a question I raised with the Deputy First Minister was, given the inefficiency of the budgetary process on an annual basis plus the significant in-year changes, that seems to me like it must incur a significant amount of sunk cost in effect of redoing, repositioning and so on. Am I right in having a sense of that as a perception? In others, is that a perception you have as well?
We don't ever start from this position. I don't think so. Clearly, we're operating within, as I've touched on, that broader UK fiscal framework. I think it would be, and I can't stay out here and give you a prescription for what a revised approach would be for the whole of the UK, but this does present significant challenges. And I think that an approach that was by the UK government that was more cognizant of the impact this has on devolved administrations and the significant responsibilities they have would be in everyone's interest. And this is not a political point, it's just a technical point about how we do these things. I think it could be improved. So clearly it creates challenges, and when we're in a situation where we're getting towards the end of the year, and on one hand we're anticipating negative capital consequences. So what do you do if you're anticipating negative capital consequences with a requirement to balance the budget? And let's not remember, we can't spend a penny over, and we have very limited capacity to carry forward, budget through the Scotland Reserve, barely more than 1%. So I've characterised it before as like trying to land a jumbo jet in a postage stamp. So this does create challenges. So I think there are various ways in which, I'm sure the committee would have various views on this as well about how that could be improved. But ultimately, is this the case for the, more broadly for every aspect of the public finances in Scotland? They're still largely driven by decisions that the UK government takes, and indeed, which to me doesn't get as much attention, but we're considering this morning, the process, and the process creates challenges as well, because when there's that asymmetry of information between the UK government and what we have, we're having to often make decisions on based upon assessment of risk. We have to take a cautious, prudential approach. We have that need to ensure that the budget balances at the end of the year. So this does create challenges, and I don't think there's anything that's inevitable about this, about the need for those particular challenges through a devolved process within the UK. Mm. I do think these things could be addressed, and I think it's something that is worthy of consideration, and certainly if the committee has any particular views on this matter that they would want to engage either with ourselves or indeed with the UK government on, be very interested to have these discussions.
I mean, you've set out what I thought and very clearly, and I suppose the point I'm making is that there's a cost to this inefficiency, and therefore, I mean, if you were working in a law firm, you would be itemising every hour you spend to say, right, well, that goes to that client, that goes to that client. Have you ever considered starting to collect the cost of this inefficiency as these fiscal events occur, or late notification of things? Because putting a number on that inefficiency, I think, could very well be quite compelling.
This is interesting, because one of the things that has emerged in previous years is around provisional outturn, is the question gets put, well, why wasn't that spent in the previous year? Well, it is going to be spent, yeah. It's being carried forward. If you were to just, for the sake of, spending something in March rather than April, that would lead to quite inefficient, whether it be allocation of capital or resource spend, simply just for presentational purposes once the accounts are published. So that is something that we obviously avoid, but we only have had, particularly in the period during the pandemic when there was significant funding coming through consequentials and sometimes late on, that could pose challenges. And we saw, for example, higher amounts in the reserve being carried forward. But all of that was discretionary spend, and all of it was applied, and there was no discretionary spend lost. Mm-hmm. So, but even But the point you make around not having that certainty, of course, that's going to lead to challenges. And I recognise particular interest from a point around public service reform. I know this committee is very much engaged on. So I do not, you know, look at this and think, is this an optimal, efficient and effective way in which to manage this sort of wider UK finances between UKG and devolved administrations? I don't. And so I'm not coming here to simply criticise. I think it is something that is worthy of further consideration. And, you know, if the committee has views on this, as I say, I would be very keen to engage, because, as I say, I feel there must be a better way in which we could do things. And I recognise there can be trade-offs, and there can be benefits to other approaches that also come with particular challenges. But I think the particular points around having to manage our in-year position with the tight constraints around what we can carry forward and the late provision of information. And that's not obvious, of course, just for the Scottish Government. That's going to be for our devolved administrations and in terms of the relationship between Treasury and other Whitehall departments as well. So it's a broader question, but ultimately it just reflects that we're still in a position where process will be driven by the UK Government's approach.
Yeah. I'll finish on this point by noting that some of the examples you've given, like post-COVID, these additional sums, they were exceptional. I think we all appreciate that. But now we've got a more bedded down fiscal framework with the recent changes. Actually, what we've done is baked in some of these inefficiencies. So it's trying to understand what that might look like. Just to follow on one brief thing before one other point from that, in terms of the fiscal framework for the Verity House agreement, to what extent will in reality the complexities, uncertainties and inefficiencies in the Scottish Government to UK Government fiscal framework be reflected in the developed fiscal framework for local councils? In other words, are they then going to, at an even deeper level than they might say before, be saying, well, this is no use to us because we can't plan? Do you anticipate that being in effect replicated as a result of what you have to deal with as a government?
I think there's things in the progress we're making towards a fiscal framework which have been reflected around baselining, where there is that opportunity in terms of the direct relationship between the Scottish Government and local government. But of course, the broader context we operate in, as we've touched on, is determined by the UK Government. So issues around multi-year funding settlements, which I know is an issue that is routinely raised by committees and members across the Parliament. Again, the challenges that can come from that, the challenges that we face are ultimately what decisions of the UK Government, what are we going to take? Now, we have been through an economically and fiscally quite volatile period, but we've been through, in the context of the UK Parliament and UK Government, politically quite a volatile period in terms of the changes of personnel at the most senior levels. So again, that creates challenges. So there will always have to be a degree of realism about what can actually be achieved. And it is important to remember, notwithstanding, you know, the aspirations that the government has around Scotland's constitutional future, Scotland is ultimately, this is ultimately a devolved government within the United Kingdom. And the decisions that the UK government takes are still going to be predominant in the context in which we operate within. So any of the work that we are seeking to achieve in terms of our relationship with local government and indeed with other partners always has to be cognisant of that context in which we operate in, and the level of discretion autonomy that is available to an independent state is not one that is available to the Scottish Government as a devolved administration. And that's just, it's not a political point, it's just stating what the facts of the matter are. And I think it comes back to that earlier point, if there's ways in which we can improve the operation of the way in which decisions are taken within the United Kingdom and the amount of information that's provided and the timelines, then I think that would be in the interest of the Scottish Government and indeed our counterpart devolved administrations.
I'll watch that with interest. My last point concerns a question I raised with you before regarding police pensions, and I had asked, and thank you for your reply back, to what extent had the increase and therefore the provision for that being as a result of COVID-19. And thank you for replying, which you, I think, without paraphrasing, pointed out that no, it wasn't due to that, and it gave an explanation about moving from final salary to career average pension scheme. But my follow-on question then is that given that that legal change that, you know, that within that, the legal challenge, rather, that also applies to other public sector professions such as teachers. They had the same issue, but we've seen a difference from police officers retiring, the rate at which, rather, and therefore the provision you need to make as compared to teachers. So I'm not, it doesn't necessarily mean that it was entirely due to the change to their pensions arrangements if it didn't equally apply to teachers. Have you got any reflections on that?
If you let me take that away, and I'll speak with pensions officials. I don't want to give you an off-the-cuff answer to that, Ms Thompson, if I were going to consider it in more detail, but I'll speak with pension officials, and if you're happy, I'll write back to you directly and copy the committee in.
Okay.
Thank you. Should anyone get any more final questions now? Michael, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. Can I come back, Minister, to the NHS capital budget? I look forward to seeing the detail that you can provide to us in terms of those list of projects. Do you have any indication, you mentioned it in one of your early answers, around the amount of that money that is being taken up by inflation of the £235 million? Is that a figure that's coping with construction inflation, and do you have an idea about the proportion of that?
I can't give you a specific analysis of what that would relate to in terms of its the sort of time value of that resources compared to, you know, 12 months ago or 18 months ago or 24 months ago. But it's, I think there's broader, will be broader statistical analysis in terms of the overall impact of inflation within the construction sector and that's impact upon capital projects, which I'll be happy to source and provide to you.
I suppose our questions are related to the pipeline of work. And really, the, you know, so we've heard ministers, and I think yourself included, talking about 10% cut, as you call it, in capital expenditure, which seems to have resulted in a 100% cut in capital projects going forward in the NHS. So a full pause, waiting for further clarity. So getting an idea in terms of how much of that is about legacy spend that is committed, that has to be coped with, and across that point, I think would be very useful. Can contrast that a little bit to your approach in net zero and just transition, so that the NHS has gone up by £235 million in capital spend. The net zero and just transition has net decrease of £217.9 million. Is that a decision you've taken as ministers, or is that just the reality of where the projects find themselves?
There'll be, you touched on it yourself around always with capital spend, where there are existing commitments, for example, and requirements to be met. And I know that's been of some interest in terms of the capital allocations for the 24-25 budget. But examples within the net zero portfolio where there can just be, it's not been possible to deliver particular projects, or in terms of the profile of projects that's going to fall on another financial year. So there can be that movement, and obviously given the horizons over which capital projects are developed and actually actioned, can go across multiple financial years as well. So there's a reflection of a number of different factors, and there can be occasions as well, more broadly across the budget, including in resource, where we have demand-led schemes where demand has not been as anticipated at forecast, which means, and what we've sought to do as well particularly, is to be identifying as early as possible where that may emerge so we can see effective reallocation of the resource. So in situations, for example, in net zero, there are some areas where it just has not been possible to deploy the resource in year, and as part of that in-year management, the capital has been reallocated.
It's quite a striking contrast, though. So you're right in terms of the detail you provided to us. So lots of delayed capital spend, heat and building projects, vessels, piers programmes, port works at Uig, Ardrossan, Gourock. None of these. Is this portfolio worse at delivering capital expenditure and capital programmes than the NHS?
I think it just reflects the particular circumstances that, that are attending to these particular projects. As I say, the their commitments are there, but in terms of the actual timeline for delivery. As I touched on earlier with capital, there's various different aspects and different factors that can have a bearing on the timeline of delivery for capital projects. So I think elements of that, and we've touched on it around business cases as well, that is reflected in some of the decisions that have been taken there in that particular portfolio.
Would you worry, I suppose, when you're taking the education side of this as well, so there's a net decrease of £98.8 million in terms of the expenditure in that area. It feels a little bit like we can spend on short-term coping investment, but we're really struggling to do some of these longer-term projects, investing in the economy, net zero, education. Is that something is that representative of your feeling around how we're delivering this capital expenditure?
I think in general terms, I think you touch on a very important point, which is in any programme of public service reform or spend to save or investment, when budgets become constrained, and this is one of the effects that we're still reeling from the austerity we have had at various points over the last 14 years, there is that, I think, for any government, there will be that need to focus on the key mission-critical tasks on a day-to-day basis. And often the challenge that we have with reform is a need to identify that parallel funding to support that change and to support that transformation. That's something that's just a general point that all governments have to contend with. What we are seeing feeding through in terms of particularly next year's budget around capital is the consequences of the decisions that have been taken by the UK government, which predominantly still impact the discretionary fund that we have available. And we are trying to manage that in a way that is consistent with the principles and values that the government has articulated, and recognising the key central role that the NHS plays, not just in terms of its delivery as a public service, but as a key economic actor within the wider Scottish economy as well, and the key expectations that both Parliament and indeed the public have that it is resourced adequately. That again is what has been reflected in the decisions that we've taken.
I mean, is that really the case around the capital, that we've got a very under-delivered programme that's got huge backlogs in it already, and what you're doing is you're pausing all new developments in order to try and bring the backlog of programmes in the capital development plan forward?
Well, with regards to in terms of the work on capital, of course, is projects have been impacted by what we have been through over the last, 4 years now since the outset of the pandemic, and we came out of a pandemic into a cost crisis. I mean, it's remarkable if we think about the last 4 years, a global pandemic, the worst in the century, a cost of living crisis and inflation, the highest level since the 1970s, major conflict in the European continent, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think the Prime Minister with the shortest tenure of any in British history, and a catastrophic mini-budget. That is the environment we're operating in. Some of these factors are global, they're macroeconomic, they're not in the gift of any one government. Some are a consequence of either being exacerbated or are directly attributable to decisions that the UK government has taken. So that is the context for all capital projects and all investment decisions that have been taken over the last 4 years. And I think that is something that we're having. It is extremely challenging, but we're seeking to work our way through that and to be very transparent about how we're doing so.
Last one on the education side of things. I noted that there was a £29.8 million increase to the SQA to support its ongoing activities. Could you tell us what that's for? I mean, this is an organisation that in 2021 we were told wasn't fit for purpose and had to be scrapped. The leadership was failing. Should we be giving them £29.8 million to spend on something when ministers already decided that they're not capable of running their own organisation properly?
Just to clarify, I sought to provide an answer to the convener earlier on, but this was an increase as a result of pay awards, increased to appointee costs, inflation elements and other operational costs. So it's paying operational expenditure.
Okay. Can I finish on the area around the social security side? When you've touched on some of those already, the £284.2 million increase in the demand-led side of this, and it's, I think, the net impact across the two. There's under provision is about £50 million. I understand that. I mean, there's been an extraordinary rise in out-of-work benefits since the pandemic, I think, which is a huge challenge across the UK and internationally. I think it's a situation. Is that something that ministers are discussing in terms of, you talk about a demand-led budget? That must be a real concern for ministers in terms of our ability within resources to cope with that if that trend continues.
Yeah, it is something that we, of course, monitor carefully. The forecasts obviously are produced by the SFC, but we of course monitor that position carefully, both in terms of the in-year management, but also in terms of these longer term trends. On the broader point, clearly in terms of those who are not in work due to ill health, this is something I think is topical. There's been coverage in the press today. But it was also something that the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy, Mary McCallum, touched on recently in a speech that she delivered, recognising that particular challenge and considering in the role that we all have to play right across government and being able to support more people back into the workplace. So in terms of the social security aspect, monitoring in year, that is something that we, of course, pay very careful attention to. We have that focus as well upon what the longer-term trends are. And then the broader point around labour market and inactivity is something that we're, I know the Cabinet Secretary is keen to engage on.
So, I mean, there's the clear economic effects around that in terms of people not being participant in the workforce. I think that would be a concern to us in terms of the taxation take available. But I wonder, I mean, is this something that's been discussed, maybe you're not there, but at the Cabinet? Because it feels to me that we've got this trend that appears to be more pronounced in Scotland, although it's significant across the whole of the UK. Mm-hmm. But we also have a unit cost of this which is higher in Scotland in terms of the decisions taken by the government and the way that they're spending money on social security payments. So we're more exposed in the country, and we already know that the kind of the £1.3 billion of shortfall against the block grant allocations by 27-28 against the social security budget. I mean, is it something that you think that the government is getting a grip of in terms of understanding its exposure in this position? And has it got a plan to actually do something about it? I know you're saying you're aware of it, but what's the government actually going to do to try and deal with it?
To say we're aware of it, I think it was just addressing the point that we recognise that issue too. And so, of course, we are giving consideration around how government responds to those trends going forward. This is still quite a young system that we have in Scotland. It's, and of course, we will, I think, collectively, we will develop an understanding the longer this system is in place and the further it embeds. But we are appreciative of the points that you articulate around long-term sustainability and resource. So again, it is something that we are giving very careful consideration to, that will inform decisions we take around the budget. But it's important to recognise the support that is being provided through the system, the social security system, is invaluable to the individuals, of course, who receive it. And it is an investment within in the people of Scotland as well. So it's important that in terms of discussing this matter is that we recognise that impact for the individuals who receive that support and do not ever allow that to be lost in talking at high level about numbers. But the point you make ultimately is there's a need to be able to meet this expenditure. There's a need to be able to meet it on an ongoing basis. And that is something that we take very seriously, both in terms of from the perspective of public finances, but also from the perspective of the administration of the social security system directly.
Okay. Thanks, Kabir.
Thank you. John?
Thanks, convener. Just perhaps touching, going back to some of the stuff that's already been touched on, I was interested in Mr. Mackay's earlier statement about, you know, based on discussions with the Treasury, because I think I had imagined, obviously wrongly, that, you know, in England they spend 100 million on the NHS and then we get 8 point something million as a consequential. So it's all quite kind of factual, the figures are there, and it just is kind of automatic. And so, based on discussions with the Treasury, suggests it's a lot more subjective than that. Is that because the Treasury themselves do not know what the spending in England is? So they actually don't know if the NHS is going to maybe overspend a bit or underspend a bit, and that in itself would impact on us. Is that part of the problem?
I don't want to risk in any way being perceived as seeking to speak on behalf of the Treasury, but I'll perhaps ask Scott if he can offer some reflections from the official experience.
So the final figures are firmly based on the allocations to the changes in funding for UK departments. Obviously, there's as we go through the supplementary estimate process, there's negotiation between the individual Treasury teams and the equivalent UK departments as they refine what the requirement is for the supplementary estimates. So it's a developing position. And what we obviously try and do is engage with our Treasury team to try and get a sense of how that position is going to pan out. You know, as we've said already, we've got this requirement that they know we need to deliver our budget revision to a certain timetable, and there's a commitment from them that they will give us, you know, an emerging picture as early as they can in the, you know, as we move into January. So we've got an idea of how things are developing, and then we take a judgment on what we can put in the SBR in terms of funding in advance of having that final sign-off. But that final sign-off is absolutely Barnett-based. It's all related to, you know, there's a line-by-line analysis of, you know, the individual changes for UK departments that we get.
And the timescale for that will be well after the year end.
No. That comes. You know, that's what the minister was referring to earlier. You know, we got that by the end of February, but obviously that's too late for us to have the incorporated all that detail into the.
So it sounds like it's not a lack of willingness on their part, but that also they're a wee bit in the dark, because I mean sometimes we get announcements at Westminster, we're going to spend 100 million on X. And I think it came up during COVID quite a lot. We don't know if that's new money, in which case we get a share, or it's reallocation of existing money. So is that kind of part of the problem as well?
Yeah.
Just before you come in, Scott, just as a point, I mean, we're fifth today, isn't it? We're 4 weeks or so before the end of the year, the start of the next financial year, and we've got a UK fiscal event tomorrow.
Yes.
And everything that we know about it, you know, in government and indeed I think around this table, is based upon what speculation we would have read in the newspapers. So in terms of that overall process, you can understand the challenges. That I think is just reflective of the sort of some of the broader challenges that can emerge in terms of knowing what the UK government is going to do. But sorry, come back in, Scott.
So Treasury are usually pretty good at giving us an indication as to whether it's new money or from existing budgets. And the default is usually always it's going to be from existing budgets. There is always a challenge, though, because funding can be announced and Treasury will say, well, that is new money, but then the amount can be refined over the course of the year, or it can turn out that we don't actually get confirmation of that amount until supplementary estimate. So they only do a main estimate and one supplementary, so there's limited opportunity for those updates of the in-year position. So sometimes you can have a situation where, I mean, we could talk about the local government money, the 500 million that was announced. So Treasury have said to us that is new money. It might be that that's confirmed in the budget tomorrow. It might be that we don't get that till main estimate. It might even be that we don't get it confirmed until supplementary estimate. because all the time there will be a dialogue between the Treasury team and the Spending Department on what their actual requirement is. And, you know, the UK government have rehearsed, you know, publicly the pressures that are on public spending, and that additional funding is only given on the basis of absolute need. So often things can be left right to supplementary estimates, because that's when they're getting the final position from a UK department on what their actual funding requirement is. So, you know, there's been pressure on all UK departments to contain spending, and that's what filters through at the end of the year.
Okay, I mean, I think it is helpful that help us understand the position that you're in as well. I mean, I have to say, when we get to the end of the year and there's an overspend or an underspend, I kind of look at, is it around 1%? And if it's around 1%, I have to say, I think that's very good. And I know the numbers are very big, so 1% is quite a big number. But I think for most of us, our own personal spending, or, you know, we would never get it within 1%. Most businesses wouldn't get it within 1%. So that's just by way of comment.
And the thing is, if we didn't land it slightly more than 1%, but if we could not land it within that space, I mean, we have to work to effectively target almost some underspend so we don't go over. And if we went beyond that 1%, slightly more than 1% in terms of what the reserve represents as a carry forward, then that would be resource or capital lost. So it is a challenge, and I think I hope you know, collectively as a parliament, getting a bit more accustomed to that particular reality, and that when underspends are reported as part of a provisional outturn, it is actually just part of the routine operation of the fiscal framework, rather than some suggestion that there has been resource that could and should have been allocated that wasn't.
Yeah, well, I fully agree with that. If I can just move on to some specifics then, and I'm going through the guide really, so hopefully the paragraphs match. Not every paragraph.
Well, that's good. That's fine.
I will stay within the 22 minutes that you took. Paragraph 18 talks about some overspends or additional funding for Children's Reporter, Social Services Council, Children's Hearing Scotland. I mean, I don't know if that is just strictly a pay increase or if there's other factors, because, as I think you know, the committee's been concerned about the number of commissions and commissioners and, you know, kind of semi-separate organisations. And, you know, I'd be concerned if the costs were kind of slipping on that.
Let me see if we can bring up the details. If we can't, we'll follow up.
Struggling for that.
No, on the specific points, are you getting information there, Scott?
I mean, this is largely pay and inflationary pressures that are having to be funded.
Okay. Well, I mean, as long as I haven't checked back to see what the percentages were, but, I mean, obviously pay is going up 7% or thereabouts. Another one, I mean, some of these are quite small amounts, but it's kind of principles I'm thinking about. Paragraph 26 talks about the COVID inquiry and £4.75 million. It does concern me a little bit with some of these inquiries that the costs can run away, and that, I think, happened with the Edinburgh trams. Is there a real control on these, or is it very much up to the person leading the inquiry what the costs end up being?
I think we're all familiar with the rules that govern these inquiries and the autonomy and independence in that matter.
Complete autonomy.
As I say, when inquiries are established and trained, we of course know we comply with the legislative requirements around that.
Okay. We've already mentioned, I think, the prisons, paragraph 47, the Justice and Home Affairs portfolio, and it talks about the reprofiling of capital for HMP Highland, HMP Glasgow. I mean, is your anticipation that there's been such high inflation with construction costs that might actually come down, and so we could actually save money in the long run, or is it the case that if we reprofile, the costs are inevitably going to go up?
Well, I think the environment we're operating in right now is reflective of that sustained inflation that we've seen and touched on earlier. Inflation is still would have been regarded probably as quite high had it not been for the context we've just emerged from. So we've set out what we touched on earlier, what the reasoning and rationale there is, as well as that there's, you know, broader challenges within the construction sector around capacity. So it's just it's reflective of a number of different factors.
So costs could go up further, or they could come down a bit, actually. We just don't know.
If I could, given the various factors that can impact upon capital projects, including, you know, some of them geopolitical, as we've touched on, I would not be in a position to say where I think things will be a year from now, 2 years, 5 years from now. I would defer to the, you know, the broad suite of, you know, independent forecasts and assumptions that are freely and publicly available in these matters.
Okay. I mean, we have talked about the capital expenditure and the borrowing, so a note in paragraph 89, it says the improved position has allowed the capital borrowing requirement to be reduced by 150 million from 450. So that means the plan is to borrow 300 million, although that could presumably still vary by the end of the year.
The decisions around borrowing are one of the few flexibilities we have, and these decisions are taken at the end of the year. But the capital position has allowed us to move to the position that you've outlined.
OK, so although the target's to borrow the 450 million, which I think is the maximum we're allowed, again, it's likely year by year that we'll end up slightly below that.
Yeah.
And then on the financial transactions money, I think that's 53 million deferred to 24-25. Can you explain to us what impact that actually has? I think some of that was used for housing in the past, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I appreciate that's been a matter of some interest in terms of the role of the financial transactions budget. Correct me if I'm wrong, Scott, this was a fairly late notification around financial transactions reduction, and we got agreement with Treasury to defer that into the following year, given the lateness of the notice.
There was a very late upswing in the negative consequential. So we've been allowed to defer it. In terms of your question about use of financial transactions, it's essentially, you know, the two largest users of financial transactions have been housing and the National Investment Bank.
Right, yeah.
Obviously, the squeeze on FT budgets generally, because the profile of the budget available is going down, means that there's less available. That's compounded by the negative that we need to manage.
But that could mean there's a little bit of leeway next year in these two areas of SNB and housing.
Could you clarify your question, Mr. Mason?
Specifically on the financial transactions money, where Mr. Mackay has just told us it mainly goes to SNB and housing, that could mean there's a bit more leeway next year, or is that already built into the budget?
Well, we've set out the position for 24-25, but as we're reflecting on today, what the final budget for 24-25 will be determined by decisions that the UK government takes. I made reference there will be a fiscal event tomorrow. I don't know what's going to be within that. And then there'll be the process of mains and supplementary estimates. There is, of course, anticipated to be a general election this year, so there's a number of factors that can impact upon the Scottish budget position over the course of the year. So we've got a position that we've set out on the face of the budget document, and any changes that materialise over the course of the year via UK government fiscal events, of course, will be reflected in a normal way through the budget revision process.
Okay, thank you. And my final point in paragraph 101 under the Scotland Reserve, the idea that you know, over time the Scotland Reserve could become more of a genuine reserve for funds, so we save a bit. But I mean, at the moment, as the government points out, there's just not the leeway to do that. I mean, do you anticipate that at some point in the future we might actually be able to put money aside, or do you think the pressure to always spend as much as we can is too great?
I think that we've seen the Scotland Reserve operate in different ways. Clearly, given the way in which we have to balance our budget, it's
it's unavoidable that there will be some underspend generated, and sometimes that underspend will emerge, you know, after the end of the year. But we also saw it play an important role when we received light consequentials, particularly coming out of the pandemic period, where we have been able to, which has allowed us to ensure that the spend is, or that the resources better aligned with the optimal time to spend. So we've seen the reserve operate in these two particular ways. As to whether it does develop into something that can be more of a reserve rather than as a function for allowing money to go from one year to the next, that of course will depend upon a number of factors, and most prominently of course being the fiscal settlements that we receive from the UK government going forward, as well as of course demand, commitments, policy, etc. So you must tell us, Phil.
Just, you know, the forward projections on the tax position currently show quite significant positive reconciliation impacts on income tax. And the scale of those is such that they'd be taken up, if you were depositing, you know, one of the things that's floated, that we would deposit, you know, positive reconciliation in the reserve against future negative reconciliation impacts. But the scale of, you know, those could be so significant that it's taking up quite a significant chunk of the reserve, even with the additional flexibility that, you know, the growth that we're now, we will see in future following the fiscal framework renegotiation. So, you know, if you think a couple of reconciliations of £400 or £500 million, you know, that would exceed the limit in the, and we need that flexibility for, you know, as the Minister says, for year on year.
Okay, no, that's helpful. That will be something we'll return to. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Jamie. To follow by Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. Morning, Minister and colleagues. Just to go back, Liz Smith and Michael Marra covered a lot on the capital spending, additional capital spending in the NHS. I did want to just check. I mean, you said you'll provide further information. Just wondering, will that include a breakdown of obviously projects, but also where the cost increases are inflationary, but also perhaps non-inflationary cost increases, and also where it's they come from new capital projects, and also whether there are refurbishment issues, etc. And the reason why I ask that is because, obviously, with you know, it's a concern that's been raised a number of times with myself in terms of where we've seen this moratorium on new bills. That means our NHS boards are going to have to invest more heavily in refurbishment to, or likely to have to invest more in refurbishment, because they're not going to be able to have the new hospitals or new facilities. So will that information be provided in your contribution back to the committee?
So in terms of a high-level impact of inflation upon capital projects and construction pressures within the construction sector, certainly we can incorporate that in to the response to the committee.
But I'm also interested to know where it's not just in issues of inflation, where there are just simple cost overruns as well. So if that could be included as well.
Okay, certainly we'll endeavour to provide as much information as we can to reflect what the asks of the committee have been.
Okay. Can I just ask on a technical or a kind of technical and process point of view? Obviously, there are you've identified areas where you can invest more or put more capital spending in, or need to put more capital spending in. How does that process happen in terms of how are these areas, how are these individual projects identified? What kind of timescales are they identified through?
In terms of capital projects within the pub?
In terms of this, in terms of these revisions?
In terms of the revisions, well, again, that, as I said, we're happy to come back and see if we can cover some of this in terms of our correspondence, but the allocations, again, this is expenditure that has, this is capital, obviously, within year as opposed to the next financial year, and it is there to support the existing position and ongoing cost pressures that that we're finding within the health portfolio. So the capital is allocated to support the existing capital activity taking place within this financial year. But I think in that broader point you'd asked about with regards to what those pressures are, and indeed in terms of capital and the way in different ways in which capital is used, for whether it be new projects or maintenance, for example. So that relation of capital expenditure in regards to construction and maintenance, I'd be happy to try and pick up some more detail on that.
Okay, I suppose what I'm asking is when do you first become aware, or is it kind of confirmed that this project is going to need extra additional support in the current financial year, and how does that process work through?
Maybe I want to touch, Scott, just in terms of the engagement that takes place within government in terms of identifying priority spend areas. So,
I mean, obviously we've got well-established monitoring processes that all portfolio areas feed into, with spending projections on both resource and capital, you know, they're signalling as early as they become aware of, you know, additional funding requirements over the course of the year. And, you know, part of what we've been talking about is the challenge of juggling those, mm-hmm. With the funding uncertainty that we have. So you've got in-year monitoring. We also have obviously well-established programmes, and an awareness of the overall capital portfolio of projects across each portfolio and the scope to vary the profile of those over the course of the year. So there's active management of that programme in year, where if, you know, we know there's slippage in one area, that, you know, there's scope to advance some expenditure in other areas. So there's a dialogue over the course of the year about what capacity exists in individual portfolio areas to take redeployed.
So would some projects, for example, to use your terms, be reprofiled to allow additional capital to be moved for other projects that are under, so have difficulties?
So yeah, we'd actively manage that over the course of the year. But it's important to recognise that across portfolio, there's, you know, it's easy to think of infrastructure or capital budgets supporting just, you know, new infrastructure projects. But there are other elements. There's research and development expenditure is capitalised and funded from capital budgets. There's, some of the equipment in the NHS, for example, is a key area for investment, and obviously that kind of thing you can bring forward more easily than, you know, building a new medical centre or whatever. Those kind of judgments on what is available and how we can deploy that. There are areas that are more easily switched on than others, I guess, is the point.
Okay, this is what I'm just trying to clarify, the kind of process behind it. But what, you know, there are, as you say, areas where perhaps there is decisions are made to prioritise one over the other. Now, it might be perfectly reasonable priorities, but it could be that there are projects that are reprofiled, put on hold, slowed down, whatever, to deliver in other areas, to deliver areas where there's an overspend or inflationary issues. Okay. Just very quickly, sorry, it's on the issue around the vessels and piers in ferry services budget. Of the 75 million and of the 41 million, how much of that is capital and how much of that is resource? Are you able to? Sorry. So I should have given you a little bit more notice on that one.
Just give me one before the numbers up. Yes. Yeah. Is there any letter?
So the 75 is entirely capital. What was the 40, sorry?
Oh, sorry, that was for the small vessels replacement programme, phase one.
Yeah, entirely capital.
They're both entirely capital, okay. The only reason I was going to ask is in how that sits REP funding, but also if they're capital budgets, that wouldn't apply. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Thank you very much. And I also thank Gillian. She was going to ask some questions, but we've just been informed the last couple of minutes that you're supposed to be due to another committee, which we did not know before we started the process. Otherwise, we might have been a bit tighter on our time. I was also going to ask, incidentally, about small vessels, given my own constituency interest, but we have a statement this afternoon on Ferguson that came up there. So with that, we will end our questions with regard to the instrument, and what we'll do is now move to formal consideration of the motion on it. I now invite the Minister to speak to and move motion S6M 12053 that the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2023 Amendment Regulations 2024 draft be approved. The members have any further comments? They do not. I now put the question on the motion.
So formally moved.
Apologies. I now put the question on the motion. Now you've moved it. The question is that motion S6M12053 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. So I'd like to thank the Minister and its officials for their evidence. We'll publish a short response to the Parliament setting out a decision on the regulations in due course. I'll now suspend the meeting briefly for a couple of minutes to allow a change of officials before we move on to the next agenda item. As soon as you're... Item on our agenda, we will now take evidence from the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on the Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2024. For this item, Mr Arthur is joined by Robert Souter, Senior Tax Policy Advisor at the Scottish Government. I welcome Mr Souter to the meeting and invite Mr Arthur to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2024 specifies the standard rate and lower rates for Scottish landfill tax, which would apply from 1 April. They are consistent with the rates set out in the Scottish Budget 24-25, published on 19 December 2023. The order sets out that the standard rate will increase from £102.10 per tonne to £103.70 per tonne. The lower rate for less polluting inert materials will increase from £3.25 per tonne to £3.30.
30p per tonne. Committee members will wish to note that they match landfill tax rates in the rest of the UK for the financial year 24-25, as confirmed in the UK and Welsh budgets. The Scottish Government is continuing to act to avoid any potential for what is referred to as waste tourism to emerge as a result of material differences between the tax rates north and south of the border. The increased rate provides appropriate financial incentives to support delivery of our ambitious waste and circular economy targets. And I'll conclude there, Convener.
OK, well, thank you very much. I mean, I've noticed that over the last 8-9 years, the inflation rate has been 31.5% in the UK, but the standard rate has gone up by 23.6% and the net rate by 25%. I'm just wondering why. I realise you've been effectively mirroring UK rates, but why it's increased by the lower than the rate of inflation, given that the whole purpose is to try and reduce the amount of landfill. And indeed, I think over the last decade there has been a very significant reduction in the revenue from that, despite the cost going up.
Well, indeed, the revenue is declining, is forecast to continue declining as the per the policy intent and objectives. The rationale for the rate being what it is in terms of that consistency with UK and Wales is, as I set out in my opening statement, to avoid the risk of so-called waste tourism from emerging. So that is the rationale underpinning the approach that we've taken with the tax.
Yeah, so there's never been any divergence, has there? But has there been any look at what the actual cost of shipping a tonne of waste is, 100 miles, for example, because if it's £3 a tonne, it doesn't for inert waste, for example, it doesn't seem very much. Doesn't look as if, I mean, to save £3, are you really going to ship a tonne of waste, you know, from Edinburgh to Newcastle or wherever?
Well, I can appreciate there will be a range of views, but along with seeking to mitigate against that risk, we've always wanted to provide a degree of certainty and stability for the sector as well. And given that we have that clear target towards the end of 2025, we've taken an approach around tax policy which is consistent with that.
So I understand now that the proportion of inert waste is now about 35-40%. Is that a significant increase on where it was a decade ago?
On that particular point, Robert, do you have any information you're able to share?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yes, is the share of inert waste as part of the total amount going into landfill increased over the last decade? Has it remained fairly stable?
So I don't have the exact numbers, but yes, it has increased slightly, largely as a result of non-inert waste producing more quickly.
Okay, and so why do you think that inert waste is not reducing quite so quickly? Is that because there's no tax incentive to change, for example?
So for non-inert waste, why are we talking about kind of household waste, black bin bag waste, there's been increases in recycling and a shift towards incineration. So yeah, there isn't the same available options for inert waste.
I mean, this is obviously is because we're having an evidence session after this on not a dissimilar issue, I suppose, and I'm just wondering, the £102, 10 pence that we have in the current financial year seems quite a disincentive, but the £3.25 doesn't. That's why I was wondering why that's impacted significantly on the level of inert waste going up relative to non-inert.
Well, it's certainly, I think, an important observation, but of course the policy around landfill tax just sits as part of a broader suite of objectives around achieving a circular economy, which I know that the committee has been taking a keen interest in, and indeed I'm conscious that more broadly the committee will be obviously beginning its scrutiny of the aggregates tax bill as well, which I'm looking forward to engaging indeed with the committee on.
And Jim, just one last question. There's been across the UK a significant increase, understanding, fly tipping. Do you know what the level of increase of fly tipping is in Scotland, and whether or not the tax on non-inert waste has impacted on that? Because there are suggestions that that may have had an impact.
On the specific interaction between the lower rate and the
quantity of fly tipping we're seeing. I don't have any direct data analysis I can share around a correlation at this point, but happy to...
Sorry, not the low rate, the higher rate. Cause, I mean,
the higher rate,
if it's over £100 a tonne, you know, OK, the revenue to the Scottish Government is decreasing because less is going into landfill, but is that because there's a genuine change in behaviour at a significant degree, or is fly tipping going up, or more likely both?
I can't speak to what the particular factors are in terms of influencing that behaviour and to be able to isolate what element the relevant tax rate is on that particular behaviour. Clearly, SEPA work with a range of partners to address this issue, and it sits more broadly within the broader environmental and circular economy policy areas. But if there's a particular interest in terms of any analysis being undertaken around the interaction between the higher rate and the propensity for fly tipping in particular areas, I'm happy to go and take that away to find out if there's any further information we can provide. I would, of course, note that the rate that we do have is on par with the rest of the UK. Would you want to come in, Robert?
No, nothing else.
Yeah, I mean, of course it's on the par with the rest of the UK, but I mean, if someone's got 20 tonnes of stuff, they might pay somebody £500 to dump it in a field as opposed to £2,000, you know, in tax. That's the issue. So it's just so my concern is perhaps that the inert waste is not taxed at a high enough rate to change behaviour, and the other rate is perhaps taxed higher than it maybe could be, despite the fact that it's increased below and level of inflation to encourage more responsible dumping.
I'm happy to take that away. As I've touched on in my opening statement, there's a long-standing position that we have adopted with regards to landfill tax, consistent with the other administrations in the UK. And as we are seeing these forecast reductions in revenue over the coming period, that I think reflects the policy objective in terms of the biodegradable municipal waste ban at the end of 2025, that the direction of travel is consistent with meeting these ambitions.
And private companies and local authorities are actually very responsible in how they deal with waste. You know, they follow the regulations that are applied, but has there been any prosecutions of unlicensed and unregulated dumpers, so to speak?
I don't have that information available, Convener.
Because, again, I mean, there is a kind of anecdotal, what's the... a BBC programme about this, which was about England, but I don't think it will be much different in Scotland at the high, because of the increase in fly tipping. There's a kind of people feel some businesses feel they're very highly regulated, whereas SEPA turn almost a blind eye to those who aren't, and therefore there's, you know, the money that's coming in revenue is decreasing, not just because less is going into landfill, but more is going being thrown over hedges and dumped in fields.
I think it's a broader suite of questions around enforcement and the role of other partners who play in that. Of course, in terms of around the collection administration and enforcement around the actual collection of the tax, that's obviously a matter for Revenue Scotland, who operate independently as a relevant tax authority. But in terms of the specific questions you raised around the interaction of tax policy with specific behaviours, I'm happy to take that away and come back to the committee just to establish what, if any, analysis has been undertaken on these specific points and to ensure that the committee is furnished with any relevant information that we hold.
I can appreciate that, Liz.
Yeah, I mean, I think it is this issue that the convener's on just now about whether... the measures that we have just now to deal with the problem are effective, and I think I'm correct in saying there have been a couple of prosecutions in Scotland about this, but it's about the deterrent factor, and I just wonder what modelling has been done about that very point as to, you know, whether this is going to have a really big effect on deterrent.
Okay, so this is, I think, clearly issues around broader behaviour in regards to complying with environmental regulations goes beyond just tax policy and the ministerial colleagues who lead in those particular areas. So I would not want to be speaking in an area where I don't have a direct policy lead, but recognising the role that tax plays, I think there are important points that have been raised, and what I would want to be able to do is have an opportunity to take that away and come back to the committee just to speak what element that factors into the considerations around race. As I've set out, but a broad underpinning principle has been that consistency with the rest of the UK in terms of the rationale, but in terms of the points that the committee is raising, has consideration been given, well, implicit, I think, in the points that the committee has raised, and correct me if I'm wrong, is has consideration been given to changing the rate to incentivise other particular behaviours, and how would that be balanced against any potential risk of weight tourism? Would that be a fair summation?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's a very difficult area, I have to say, because I think you know, it's very hard to pick up a lot of the bad behaviour as well, and that's a really big issue. But any modelling that could be done, I think, would be very helpful when it came to behavioural change, because that's by and large what it's all about.
Indeed.
I mean, I'm convinced that people will ship a tonne of waste across the border to save a pound or whatever it would be in a tax differential. They're much more likely just to dump it in a field a mile up the road. Okay, that being said, any other questions from colleagues around the table? There don't appear to be. So the next item involves formal consideration of the motion of the instrument. So I invite the Minister to speak and move motion S6M12277 that the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Low Rate Order 2024 SSI 2024-60 be approved.
Formally moved.
Do members have any further comments? Nope. The question is that motion S6M12277 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I thank the Minister and his officials for their evidence today. I'll now suspend the meeting briefly to allow for a change of witnesses before we move on to the next agenda item. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Aggregates Tax and Devolved Taxes Administration Scotland Bill. Therefore, welcome to the meeting Jonathan Sharma, Policy Manager, Local Government Finance, COSLA, Alan Dope, Director, Mineral Products Association Scotland, and Dougie Neal, Group General Manager, NWH Group, representing the Scottish Environment Services Association. I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session. If witnesses would like to be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to the clerks and I can then call you. And rather than have an opening statement, I'm going to move straight to questions. So, for example, Mr. Doke, the policy memorandum states that the proposed SAT retains a fundamental structure of UKAL, which offers, and I quote, a degree of continuity for taxpayers, while also ensuring that devolved tax can evolve over time to support Scottish Government circular economy objectives. So how does £2 a tonne tax deliver that?
Thank you. I think it's fair to say that the £2 rate of taxation has been in place for quite a considerable number of years through the UK Aggregates Levy. And I think as part of that process, we have seen a continued growth in recycled materials and secondary aggregates being used. I think current research, certainly from the Scottish Government, has indicated that I think we're something about 89% of secondary and recycled aggregates being used within the market.
Okay, so you're basically saying that with 89%, we're almost, and you've mentioned this throughout your submission, that we're effectively reaching the kind of optimum, if you like, in terms of what can be recycled, so therefore any additional taxation that's imposed, should the Scottish Government plan to diverge, and they don't at this point, as far as I'm aware, in terms of the bill, won't actually deliver any further recycling?
Well, just in terms of the bill, I don't think the bill stipulates clearly a rate or rates.
No, but that's the government. The government's indicated that,
I think one point I suspect I would want to, or I suppose I would want to make, is in respect of the issue regarding the ongoing extraction of what you might call virgin aggregate. You have a position at the moment whereby, I say, you have 87 to 89%. I think the figure has varied over the last couple of years in terms of the documentation that's been produced. But you have restrictions and limitations on the ability of certain materials to meet the criteria that they would be required from virgin aggregate and to meet the specifications, whether that be for roads or for other projects. So I think there is a limit to how much recycled or secondary aggregates can be used. I don't think also there's been any fundamental research on what the availability is of further markets or indeed further availability of construction and demolition waste within Scotland. I think that's one of the key points I would like to try and get over in terms of, whilst there may be an objective in terms of the tax in order to drive towards the greater use of recycled materials, there is perhaps a restriction or an unknown, I think put it that way, in terms of what that availability of material might be and its consistency.
I'm going to bring Mr. Neil in a wee minute here, but last week we visited a recycling facility and they basically said that there can be on occasion limitations in terms of feedstock provision, which is something again that you've mentioned in your own submission, but they also said that there's something like 4 million tonnes of waste that could be recycled that's actually being dumped into landfill. You know, 35 to 40% of landfill, they said, is kind of effectively waste that could be recycled. Is that a figure you would recognise?
It's not a figure that's contained, for example, within the initial consultation document that came out in terms of breaking new ground. That's not the figure that's quoted within there. I don't think there's any detailed research on that level of figure in terms of its availability. And I say not only in terms of the availability or the quantity of material, but in terms of the quality of material. Another thing I should say at the outset as well, whilst I represent the Mineral Products Association Scotland, members are not just interested in the extraction of virgin aggregate. I've got members who are clearly involved in recycling. It's both aspects. It's not just it's one and the other. There is combined or businesses who combine both facets of it and seek to utilise and maximise the amount of recycled materials they can do. And we as a trade association do similarly. We also have, for example, written fairly recently to Transport Scotland on the issue about greater use of recycled materials within TS 2010, as an example. So we are mindful, as an organisation, as a trade body, about the use of recycled and secondary materials, and our members are as well.
Okay. I mean, Mr Neil, I mean, you've said in your submission that the production of recycled virgin aggregates currently benefits from the UK aggregates levy. It's therefore essential that the levy in Scotland, the Scottish aggregates tax, is maintained and also increased to ensure that recycled and secondary aggregates are competitive with primary aggregates in line with Scotland's resource efficiency aims, which I think is laudable. I'm just wondering, what about the issue that has been raised by Mr Doak in terms of the availability of these materials? I mean, I think if there is, you know, optimum utilisation or near enough at the moment, would increasing levy have the impact that you would desire, i.e., you know, a greater incentive to do more recycling? I mean, is the resource available to do that?
What I would say, I think the resource rise and falls depending on the construction and demolition markets. Right at this moment in time, we're in a little bit of a lull in terms of new builds or builds being taken down to allow the material to be extracted from building sites. But I would also caveat that and say that you touched on it in the previous, and apologies for going back to this, but when I was sitting listening to the previous meeting about the inert landfill tax maybe not being too high. So if we have a stock of what we call feedstock, we can turn that into recycled aggregates, but if there's not a market at the other end of that, it encourages more to go into landfill. And especially with a lower rate tax of £3 something, there's no financial incentive there for to bring that back to be recycled, just to turn a bigger pile into an even bigger pile. So I think that there is more that we can be doing. And what I would say as well is the recycling equipment available has come on leaps and bounds in the last 10-15 years since I've been involved in the market. So we are able to recycle more materials which would have previously went to landfill, but it's a little bit more intensive and a little bit more costly to do so. So the financial argument, you know, needs to be there for to divert more from landfill.
So what you're saying, therefore, is it to make that to enable greater investment in these new technologies that will upgrade the quality of secondary materials, you're looking for an increase in the levy. Would I be right in saying that?
Yes, and to put that into context, we've said this for as an organisation for many years. So yeah, I know that there is further down in the paper about the. Making sure, and we talked about waste tourism before, but this is kind of on the other side of the spectrum of that, to say importing stuff that maybe, or cross-border stuff, that would become very separated and divorced from what the rest of the UK are doing, which could lead to complexities in application of the rates. So I understand the consistency... And the bill sets out to be consistent, but if we're going to pull a lever here to change behaviours, then this is an opportunity I think we have.
Yeah, I mean, you've talked about secondary aggregates, and in particular incinerator bottom ash aggregate, being strongly reliant upon the aggregates tax to remain competitive in a challenging market, allowing large-scale landfill diversion and avoidance of raw material extraction. I mean, one of the issues that was raised last week on our visit was the fact that there are certain... although the quality of recycled materials is improving all the time, there's still a certain view that they're never going to be as good as primary aggregates in certain areas.
Yeah, to touch on the IBA, the incinerated bottom ash aggregate, obviously the push towards the landfill ban and the the increase of what we call energy from waste plants, where we incinerate the residual waste to power the national grid. That's led to a material which comes out the other end, basically is the ash. And as yet, and I know this is probably crossing over different departments here, we've failed to receive a waste classification for this material type, which makes it particularly difficult to get into to applications to be able to really have a market for this material. So what you're finding is a lot of this material is just getting piled up in landfill sites just now. So there is a challenge around that and what it can be used for. SEPA have issued, as you see in our submission, what they call a position statement, which means that, you know, it can be used but in a very narrow series of applications. So it can't be near to a water table, close to a river, can only go down to a certain depth. So it is very, very narrow. But if you look at our example of other countries which are maybe a wee bit more progressive on this, in the Netherlands they build runways and roads and reclaim land with this material, so there is a use for it. But I appreciate this committee here is not advising SEPA on this, so but there is a challenge that if the aggregate levy is not maintained or increased, that all that will happen is this good work that we're doing in diverting waste from landfill will end up with a secondary problem, which is incinerated bottom ash taking its place from the landfill that we're diverting.
Okay, now Mr Sharma, Cosler, in your paper you've said that should the intention be to increase the incentive to move away from sourcing primary aggregates to secondary recycled aggregates, then how might this impact on Council's ability to procure at reasonable cost? I take it you'd be looking for a kind of break whereby if local authorities or other public authorities were buying secondary or other aggregates, they wouldn't, primary aggregates would have the tax and secondary would not. So how would that have an adverse impact on COSLA if there was a bigger shift to secondary aggregates, recycled aggregates?
I think the point has already been made that it's not necessarily a completely open market for being able to access secondary, recycled aggregates. And that, I suppose the point that was being made there was similar to other points being made in the COSLA submission around the fact that councils are substantial procurers of aggregate. They also do run quarries, and within that, I suppose the point being made is that if the cost per ton, the aggregates tax rate goes up significantly, there's the issue about how would councils be able to continue to afford to do the kind of works that they have to do that require aggregates, and particularly roads maintenance and roads network. So the question there is comes back to how the aggregates tax can work with encouraging and increasing the supply of recycling.
So what you're looking to do in COSLA is you're kind of in one breath you're kind of not really keen on the aggregate tax going up because it would impact on local authorities the cost base because they'd be purchasing large quantities of those primary aggregates, but at the same time you want to encourage greater use of recycled aggregates. But are those not contradictory objectives given the fact that the levy is really required to, and to create a differential in cost so that more money can be invested in equipment to recycle by waste by companies?
I think we recognise that the aggregates, the existing aggregates levy and the how we see the aggregates tax coming in, at least initially, suggests that it is seen as it's a lever. It's part of the kind of a suite of things that can be done. And I don't think we oppose the fact that councils have to pay the tax along with any other procurer. I think the point is if we're going to have an aggregates tax in Scotland, then that is a bit different from the aggregates levy, then what we should be doing is focusing that more in terms of that kind of suite of measures, if you like, or things that could be done. Certainly heard from our COSLA's Environment Economy Board last Friday that there is a willingness, for instance, for councils to be able to produce more material, you know, from secondary, from building materials, etc., and to be able to use those. But you need investment in that as well. So I think that the point is about bringing a tax in like this. There's an opportunity here to, and I think that point was made earlier about if we're going to respond to the challenges more effectively and with a dimension that perhaps recognises the circumstances more closely here, then here's the opportunity to do that. So it's not, we're not saying that we don't anticipate that potentially that costs the actual tax rate could go up. That's obviously up for ministers to determine, but you could be looking at that in a different way, and perhaps increasing the recycling could be part of that.
Okay, so if as Mr. Neil says that they can build runways in Netherlands with recycled materials, is there no reason why roads in Scotland can't be resurfaced using recycled materials, assuming the regulations can be adapted to allow that to happen?
Obviously I'm not an expert in the roads field, but certainly the sense that I got from the board members on Friday was that that road services are the ones that are going to, if there's any significant increase in the tax rate, then they're the ones that are going to potentially experience that the most. But also, equally, there are opportunities, I think, that they're putting forward about how recycling could be looked at using secondary aggregates in a different way, and that's what we should be trying to encourage here alongside the incentivisation, if you like, of what the tax is itself.
Okay. Mr. Doke, you've said in paragraph 16 that English producers may be keen to exploit any substantial increase in the tax rates in Scotland. So, depends what you mean by substantial. What would you describe as substantial? So, for example, say the Scottish Government, and my understanding is they don't intend to, but say they decided to put it up to £3 from £2 and 3 pence, which is going to be from April. Given the cost of shipping, trucking aggregates, is a pound a tonne really going to, mean, people are going to be shipping, vast quantities of aggregates into Scotland? Because I would have thought that the actual cost of those shipments would be much higher than a pound a tonne when time you pay the fuel and the lorry and, the driver and all the rest of it. And there's not many populated areas in the close, in the Scottish side of the border, indeed, the English side of the border. Most of the cities that would use aggregate are really further to the south. So would that actually have a real impact? In other words, what's the elasticity of demand? Conversely, if the Scottish Government reduced the tax to a pound, would there suddenly be a huge demand for Scottish aggregates in England? I mean, it just seems to me a bit unrealistic. We're talking about a pound a tonne here. It just seems, either way, I'm struggling to find out how that would make a major impact in either direction.
I think you're right, Chairman, and insofar as in terms of the elasticity of the pricing, as you say, we're commenting on a bill which doesn't have a rate stated within it. We are trying to draw the point that, I say, we've heard calls for significant increases in the tax. I think, depending on the quality of the product, will depend on how far it can travel and the implications, therefore, for the actual transport costs. So you're correct insofar if it's a low-value product, is it likely to travel further as a consequence? If it's a low differential, then perhaps not. If it's a higher-value product, then there'll be more likelihood of it to travel.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of high value, I think red gravel stones is one thing which appears to be high value. There are other high value kind of primary aggregates that could be impacted by this. Either way, you know, yep. Either lowering it or increasing it.
Yep. Well, as I say, there are a variety of products that are produced at quarries, depending on the geology. You can have... And it's something we shouldn't ignore also is even in the production of a higher value product from a site, you will still potentially have a lower value product that you still have to remove in order to get to the higher value product. Mm-hmm. And that yeah. lower value product is then competing with perhaps secondary and recycled materials. So mm-hmm. there can be a knock-on effect from that side of it. Could I just touch on something that was referred to earlier? In terms of, I think the point I was trying to get across was... If we're focused on recycled and secondary materials and aggregates, I say the point I was trying to make is the figures that we've already seen out from the Scottish Government are suggesting 87-89% of construction demolition waste is already recycled. If there is potential, we don't know because we don't have that research, I would argue, to see what these other uses might be. Mr Neil referred to bottom ash as one. But there's an example where you're restrained by the quality aspects of the product, as recognised by CEPA in terms of the restrictions that they've placed on it. You won't always get secondary or recycled materials to replace virgin aggregate in terms of the quality requirements that are stipulated for various projects. I think that's the point I was trying to get across in terms of...
I think you have got that.
Both volume and quality. That's what
I think you have got that across. I think okay. We'll accept that there are some areas. I think what Mr Neil said, I don't want to put words in his mouth, but was that as the quality of recycling improves, then the differential between virgin aggregates and recycled is narrowing, and in some areas it's marginal. Would that be right in saying that, Mr Neil?
Yeah, I would agree with that, yeah.
Okay.
Good. Can I come back? Yes. Sorry. I was going to say, you see that in the marketplace at the present time. As I said, there has been for a number of years even dry recycling in terms of crushing and screening of materials returned to sites. You've then seen investment in wash plants where materials are going through a secondary process, if you like. So there's greater use of recovery of materials. Mm-hmm. So you're seeing that flow at the present time. As I say, with the tax at the current rate, that's one of the points I was trying to get across. And I think that's probably more to do with the landfill tax than it is to do with the aggregates tax.
OK, thank you. Incidentally, Gillian Mackay's had to leave because she's in the Parliamentary Bureau and she's had to go to a meeting there. She just gives her apologies. Just one further question, Mr Doak, before I open out to colleagues around the table. And that's in your very first paragraph, you talk about the extraction of aggregates in Scotland as in the rest of the UK is well managed and heavily regulated and with a strong environmental track record. And I think we recognise that. But we have had concerns raised about unregulated quarriers, etc. You know, how big of a problem or an issue actually is that, and would you like to see something in this bill that tackles that?
I think if I can jump back a small step, the approach that we have taken in terms of our engagement and response to the bill is to be asking for the establishment of the technical advisory group, which was subsequently set up, in terms of being distinctive. In terms of a tax, different potentially to the UK Ags levy, we were calling for a greater transparency, if I can put it that way, in terms of the register of sites and how sites are monitored, policed, even to the point of suggesting that there is a role beyond the implementation of the tax in terms of a working group, if you like, with Revenue Scotland, in order to ensure it's almost self-policing. So our members are keen, whatever rate of tax it is that ensure that that is a level playing field across the sector, and that it is well enforced and ensured that those who should be paying their tax are paying their tax.
Yeah, I think we would agree with that, whether it's £1, £2 or £3. We want to make sure that everybody's paying it and that your members are not being disadvantaged by paying it while competitors maybe 10 miles up the road are not regulated and not licensed and they're undercutting you. OK, I'm going to open it up to colleagues around the table now. John, to be followed by Michael.
Hey, thanks very much, Convener. On the question of kind of definitions and what commercial exploitation means and all of that side of things, we're sticking very closely, it appears, to the UK rules. Are you all comfortable with that? You're all happy with that?
Yes.
OK, yeah. I'll take that as a yes. I mean, there was suggestion from at least some people who had written into us that it could be wider, that there's products being missed which are not being taxed according to these definitions. Do any of you feel that would be the case, Mr. Neil?
No, I mean, we chose to only... We're not a taxpayer as per this bill. So, you know, our members, we chose to only answer a few of the questions that was posed. So we're not seeing anything, or I can't recall anything that would say, oh, that should definitely be included in the taxable element of this bill. So I don't have anything. So.
Right. And Mr. Doak, you're not all that enthusiastic about the tax anyway, so presumably you don't want anything.
I think our position has been that the UK AGS levy has been in operation for 20 years.
Yes.
The exemptions, the reliefs, the process, and we have seen a drive towards recycling whilst that has been imposed. So from that point of view, then it's business as usual, as much from our members' point of
yes.
view.
So you're not arguing that a particular product be taken out or anything like that? No,
no.
That's right. Mr. Sharma, you were, I think, arguing, or Cosla was arguing, that there should be certain exemptions for local authorities. And
I suppose I was going to mention a couple of things. One is that we were on the expert group that was looking at the options for the devolving the tax. So we certainly, understood, round the table why we would probably want to see this come in as something, that was stable and wasn't going to cause huge disruption initially. However, I think the discussions involved quite a range of points being made, some of which could be about what's the definitions, but the other. Certainly one thing that I did raise in that group was, where local authorities are having to, and we've talked about the availability of the recycled and secondary aggregates, that if they're having to use virgin aggregate to, for roads maintenance, et cetera, a lot of that, widely it's public benefit, but secondly, it's also about other kind of environmental measures that are being undertaken, within the circular economy kind of, principles and priorities. So active travel, for instance, so if that's going to become more expensive for councils to be able to put in those kind of projects, there's some more funding that comes from Scottish Government to there is obviously quite a substantial amount of capital investment coming from Scottish Government even as we speak around active travel. Councils also having to put their own resource in. So I put the argument forward that maybe there was some scope to look at not necessarily removing the tax, but it could be about some sort of recognition, if you like, that's why the primary aggregate is having to be used. And if there's
would you go as far as saying we could have different rates? So say in the Western Isles you've got to use a virgin material, there could be a lower rate, whereas in the central belt, when you've got a choice, it should be a higher rate?
Well, I think that's those sort of discussions, I think, merit being had. And I think, you know, bringing the tax in will be the first thing to do. But we're already, engaging with the government and Scottish Government and officers and with the other stakeholders as well. So one of the things that we plan to do is to have a local authority workshop to talk some of these through.
Right. So you haven't got a position yet as to whether you'd want a national rate or local rates?
We don't have that sort of position at this point.
Fair
in
enough.
Time.
Okay. I mean, another question that I think I was initially surprised about, but maybe I'm understanding it now, I thought the tax would have been on the point of production or at the quarry rather than when it's put into use. Now, obviously, that would cause a huge problem with the rest of the UK if we had different systems. But what is the actual logic of having it at the point of use rather than or commercial exploitation rather than at the source, Mr. Doak?
As I say, the tax has been in post for 20 years under the commercial exploitation point. And if you're looking at it from the point of view of production, I suspect then you're going to cause cash flow issues. You're going to be looking to tax material that's perhaps sitting within the quarry, sitting on the deck, that's not even yet been sold. Potentially materials... You get into the whole debate as to whether materials are actually going to go out the gate or not, because it might be lower quality material that might actually end up being left as part of the restoration of the site, so you'd be paying tax on material that's not actually been exploited. Mm-hmm. So there's a number, so I can see why for 20 years it's been on basically exploitation in terms of point of sale.
Yes. And has the experience been that any of it's kind of gone missing between the point of production and the point of exploitation? Because I'm an accountant. You know, it seems neater to me because you know where the quarry is. If something's leaving the quarry, it's easy to measure. But goodness knows where it might go for exploitation.
Not to my knowledge. No. I don't think there's been any investigations. I'm not certain. I'm not aware of any investigations from HMRC in terms of that particular issue. Uh-huh. I'm not aware of it.
I don't know if you've got views on that, Mr. Neil, or.
I could see why you would ask the question, but we're not taxpayers, as I say, for this the aggregate levy at this moment in time. But I actually do agree with Mr. Doak there that the taxation at the point of sale, I think, is very important there for the reasons that Mr. Doak gave.
Okay, thanks so much. I'll leave it to that, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Mike.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose I start from the position of wanting to make this and make sure it's as simple as possible for business across the board, and that we should differentiate things as little as possible. But I think probably the point that's in my head around this is that we want to at the same time maximise the recycling rate. And so that's probably the kind of the tension that we're trying to investigate. Various questions are around it. It strikes me from the evidence so far, there's probably in two different areas. One is about expanding the marketplace, and that might be through price competition, so that a recycled aggregate is more competitive on the basis of price, that essentially it's cheaper because you don't have to pay the tax, or through broadening the use in terms of the classification of the aggregate and where it might be used in those different places. I wanted to push you a little bit further on, I think, where the convener was going with in the start, was how much more could we actually achieve, and understanding that those are both variables within it, how much more is out there for us to then try and put in place a policy regime to advance that cause of the maximising recycling? You said we're in a kind of a lull at the moment in terms of, but is this a, in essence, is it an infinite process that as long as the price conditions are there, we could just keep finding it? Or is what's realistic in terms of how much we could push up our recycling rate and get the environmental benefits of that? Probably Mr. Neil, start off with you.
I think what I said when I said we're in a little bit of a lull, obviously to recycle material you need to feed stock material there, and there is a significant amount of that, as I said previously, going into landfill at this moment in time. But I'll speak from my own company's perspective right at this moment in time. We're currently producing 3 days a week. So we've got, you know, an extra 40% capacity there to produce more aggregates, but there's not a financial reason. Now, the market is a little bit depressed in terms of sales available there, and it's obviously hotly contested by not just the recycled market, but the primary aggregate market as well. When there's less available, prices come down, you know, the competition increases. But I think from my point of view in a recycling market, there is feedstock available to us. If the financial conditions are right, there is capacity within the system to produce more. And hopefully that answers your question.
So the question for you is more about demand,
yeah,
rather than the supply side of your business. So if the marketplace is there, then you'll be able to get more of the supply in, and you'll be able to sell it.
Yeah, there's a couple of things in that then. The classification of the waste, and when we look at the incinerated bottom ash, is quite a big topic, and how SEPA plays their role in all of this, and the applications that the material can be used in. So there is more we can be doing to broaden the scope for using recycled materials, which will help push on our sustainability and circular economy aspirations. I also think that, as I said, the increasing sophistication of the technology being used, bearing in mind this is multi-million pound investments that companies are having to make to achieve that, and we need to set the foundation stone for a market that first looks at the secondary aggregate market before it looks at primary. And just to challenge a little bit on Mr. Sharma and what he had said there is, we're actually having direct engagement with some local authorities who are not that many miles from where we actually produce this material, who are taking the view that primary aggregate is not much different, so we'll just use that because we know it's safe. And we are currently trying to open negotiations to say, you know, come and see the plant, come and see, and I know you had visited a plant previously, and see the quality that's being produced, because there is a stigma attached sometimes to 20 years ago, someone on site saying that recycled material is not of the quality as what we would expect. But things have came on so much that we need to change the perception of the industry that's using this materials while creating new opportunities for to really drive that number up. And I suppose this is a lever that we can pull in order to try and push that.
We saw some excellent sand last week, I think.
I've got that much, I'm selling it.
And I suppose that what we also heard in that visit, though, it was about that distance, and so much of the carbon impact in this is about the transport. And Mr. Sharma, would you respond to that in terms of the balance between where you source the material versus the kind of material, and how your local authority is balancing that in terms of its own carbon impact?
Obviously, I can't, you know, kind of speak for the kind of specific circumstances, but the feedback I got, from the from our board, the Environment Economy Board members, just last Friday, was that councils are actively looking at alternatives, and I heard about that they were looking at how they could. How can they make better use of their own building materials, for instance? So the message is that I think that was the point I was making before, is that if the tax is coming in, that's one lever, if you like. But let's not bring it in just as one thing. How do we encourage that if that is the case? If there are blockers there as well in terms of what councils feel legally they can do, let's explore that and see where we can go.
Thank you.
Because I think there is a willingness. So.
Okay. Mr. Doak, can I bring you back to my original question? That was a little bit of a segue back and forward, but around that capacity. Or the potential, you have a kind of a sense of the scale for the growth in this area?
Well, I think at the very outset, the point I was making about secondary and recycled materials is the lack of research that's been done in terms of the availability of okay. that material. As I've said earlier, I'm repeating myself, 87-89% of construction demolition waste, but there are then secondary materials that we're touching on. But without a sort of full understanding or knowledge of what the availability is of that material potentially to be used, both from an availability point of view and also from a quality point of view, as we've touched on. If you think in Scotland, we're producing of the order of, it can vary depending on the market, somewhere between 20 to 30 million tonnes per annum of aggregate. I think some of the figures I've seen in terms of construction demolition waste are touching, well, I think the consultation document on this particular proposed tax was suggesting about just over 1 million tonnes. I think the Chair's referred to a slightly higher figure. It's not anywhere near the 20 to 30 million tonnes. And please don't get the impression that I'm suggesting that we shouldn't be recycling or we shouldn't have the tax. I'm just trying to pull, we're looking very much in the bill from one side, yeah. but we don't have the information on the other side from the point of availability of alternative materials. And that's the point I'm trying to make. And from my perspective, I say 20 to 30 million tonnes of material. We have a list of within the country of potential objectives or through the National Planning Framework, offshore wind hydro schemes with a potentially huge demand for aggregate, huge demand. So slightly, if I can maybe jump to one of the other questions perhaps, if the bill is designed in order to see a minimisation or a reduction in terms of aggregate and the revenue it derives from it, that seems to me counterintuitive as to what the potential future demand for the materials might actually be and for the economy.
That's useful. I mean, it feels like there's a reasonable amount of consensus around that the question here is more about classification rather than and use cases rather than price point. But it feels to me. On the I want a question around this in terms of differentiated by. It feels to me there's lots of different products in this, and with some of the virgin aggregates that we're talking about that maybe have a greater export value and that frankly it is worth shipping long distances, for instance, to neighbouring areas, whether it be red chips or, you know, that are specific, as you put it, I think, to the geology of Scotland. So there's an aggregate that we can export that there is a higher price value for. Do you think there's any case to say that we should be having a more direct intervention around protecting those export or long distance markets versus something that's more localised? And I know that that's partly, I think, of the price elasticity around transport that's within that, but should we be making this more pronounced? So the use of Scottish red chip, that we should be saying that's a high price point, it's, you know, something that we can use, but actually we should be making a differentiation in the bill between some of those classifications. Putting aside how difficult that would be, but do you think there's a case to say that there should be a more direct differentiation in there? Please,
sorry,
Mr. Doak.
Yeah. Sorry, yeah. I think in terms of answering that question, I think our position has always been in terms of the one tax and one tax rate. I think even in terms of the consultation, in terms of the possibility of different tax rates within different geographical areas, I think we see that as being difficult and open to potential exploitation, perhaps.
Okay. My last area was around the CapEx, so the capital investment, I think, around this kind of the user case side of things. I mean, I find it a little bit difficult to understand that the more capital investment, sorry, I'm speaking to you, Mr. Neil, because around the kind of facilities and technology that you would want to put in that would increase the quality level and give assurance to the marketplace that you had a really high quality product, it would open up new possibilities, but that will require additional investment from the industry in those areas. And I wonder, I suppose, that at the moment your kind of model for that is that if you are able to sell more, then you can invest back. And it feels to me like that's not necessarily, we'll do that necessarily at pace. I wonder whether there's more case to say we'd be better off with a kind of a tax credit against land, a landfill tax that might be against the kind of residual unprocessed part of that waste. So the quarry, again, we visited last week, we're talking about a very significant amount of money that they have to pay to put the very last residual amount of waste into landfill. Would a tax credit against that not allow you to increase the quality of I'm just thinking, is there a different mechanism that we could advocate for? I know it wouldn't necessarily be in this bill, per se, or maybe it could be, but actually, is there a different mechanism to help you get that capital investment that might be quicker?
That's a really good question and not an answer that I can quickly form. I think that where we have been is that the company I work for very recently spent £4.5 million on a new plant. At this point in time, it was the largest plant in Europe for recycling materials. And what we've seen is that the other parts of our business that supported the generation of this feedstock allowed us to do more. Because what we were doing is the plant that we had previously had a certain capacity per hour to produce aggregates. So as soon as we got the pile so big that it made no sense bringing it into the recycling, we just took it to the local landfill tips that they could take it. So by increasing the capacity there and putting that investment in, but not all members of CSR, you know, got that level of capital expenditure available to them. I think when the market improves and people can see the return on investment for spending that kind of money, then anything that's going to encourage and support investment in this technology should be encouraged, whether that be a credit system or I'm not sure if you're suggesting to offset the aggregate tax or if this is an additional to that or what it might be. But yeah, I mean, we're more than happy to engage with whatever that may look like in order to really, you know, keep the foot pressed on the gas pedal in this area.
Yeah. I think it's just an opportunity for us to put these things to the government and ask them why, what their thinking is around how we make sure that the acceleration is there. And yeah. Taking on board colleagues' points about, and my own probably predilection within this, to make sure that it's as simple a system as possible and across border and it makes it clean. Yeah. But actually, what can we do to accelerate it? Okay, that's me, Convener. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you, Convener. It's just one small question, which arguably follows on from the Convener and Michael Mara as well. Mr Doak, in your submission, you noted that significant behaviour change is unlikely unless the Scottish Government decides to change the rate drastically. And even then, there isn't an obvious supply of alternative materials available. Now, I know Mr Mara has been kind of touching on this, but I'm still not sure that I've got a sense of that clearly enough. I mean, I thought Mr Mara made a very good point about kind of aggregates that are specific to Scotland in terms of red chips, but I'm still not clear the detail of different aggregate types, what price increase they could stand, in order to sum up to what overall potential price increase, although as everyone said, there's no plans for that on the table. I wonder if you could just help me understand a wee bit any more. I mean, of course, and as you pointedly correct, English producers may be keen to exploit any substantial increase in rates in Scotland. And I think we all understand that, but the devil surely must be in the detail. And I know we've danced around this issue a bit with two separate questions, but if you could help me understand a bit more, that would be helpful. Thanks.
I'm not sure if we're mixing up two points in terms of the issue about is there more to go at. I was referring to recycled and secondary aggregates. Yeah. I think the position that we've adopted, right, is that in terms of taxation, that should be a consistent across all products.
Right. In terms of secondary primary aggregates, and that's my misunderstanding.
The point I was trying to make in terms of not knowing what to go at is in terms of the point I've made a few times now about what is, at the moment we're looking at primary aggregates in terms of taxation, mm-hmm, and a suggestion that perhaps we increase recycled and secondary without having that detailed knowledge about what that pot actually looks like. Yeah. And what that pot can actually satisfy in terms of quality and availability and consistency.
Yeah.
So that's the point in terms of what more can you go at. Right. In terms of increasing the tax, does that change that pot on this side?
Yeah.
I don't know if it does in terms of quality and availability.
Yeah. And therefore, I mean, you're correctly and I understand introducing another kind of complexity in terms of the enactment of the bill, but that's good because that's the sort of thing we want to tease out. Have we got the data do you know that we can draw to arrive at some of these decisions? I mean, I'm not sure what data your members will routinely gather and submit as part of the existing processes that teases out all of these different areas that then the Scottish Government will have.
Yeah. Well, again, I don't want to give the misapprehension that we are not encouraging recycling. I look at the MPA website, we'll give you a list of recycled materials and our estimates of the figures of those. And I say our members are heavily involved in recycling as well as virgin aggregate extraction. And as I said, we as a trade association will seek to encourage recycling and trying to do that through either being influencing in terms of British standards or influencing in terms of Transport Scotland. We'll try to do that. I'm not sure if that answers the...
Yeah, I mean, it does. I'm not trying to get to any slam dunk or anything. I'm genuinely trying to understand. So, no, it gives me more insight, although I suspect I personally have got further to go to kind of bottom out some of this stuff, but it's helpful, thank you.
So, can I make a slightly other wee point? Forgive me if I've gone off tangent. One of our things that we are suggesting, not necessarily in response to this particular bill, but is establishment of a Scottish Minerals Forum. Mm-hmm. Which we think would be useful, particularly in relation to the point I touched on earlier in terms of the potential demand for aggregates going forward. I think there's a real need, not just in terms of the, if you look at the National Planning Guidance in terms of regulation, we talk about maintaining land banks of 10 years. We would like to see a strategic thought process beyond that, in terms of, we're talking about 2045 in terms of NPF4. There's nothing to stop that type of forum, including, as I would like to see, bodies like Heads of Planning, likes of Scots, likes of COSLA, likes of SEPA, and new issues in terms of recycled materials could be brought to the fore and discussed in that type of forum in order to ensure that, as a country, we are looking at circular economy. And that links back into the consultations that are out on the circular economy, which we again have made representations on. Mm-hmm. And that sort of makes similar points.
Okay, no, that's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much, and thanks to colleagues for their questions. Mr. Sharma, just one last question to you. You're a member of the expert group, which began in January last year and has met on 5 occasions. Can I ask you who else is, which other organisations are on that expert group?
Off the top of my head, I probably couldn't. I mean, it's a whole range of... people from the business community, obviously ones that are working in this area. So I can provide a list if that's helpful from the last minute.
But do you consider it quite a balanced group in terms of all points of view?
I would say that we probably... we were invited onto that group. We're obviously coming from a local government point of view. I think primarily the group was a consultation, kind of entity with a range of stakeholders, and that probably did reflect the business community to quite a significant extent. But it didn't mean that we weren't able to kind of get our points across. They have heard some of these before, so. I don't know if you can.
I think
wants to come in.
No, I've got a copy of the last minute, well, one of the sets of minutes. So you had Chartered Institute of Taxation, British Ceramics Federation, Confederation, MPA Scotland, Chartered Institute of Building, CESA, BGS, British Geological Survey, COSLA, British Glass, Transport Scotland, British Aggregates Association, Institute of Chartered Accountants, SEPA, Zero Waste Scotland, and obviously Revenue Scotland and Scottish Government. Well, no, that's just a list of who were at.
So it's fairly comprehensive. That's really what I was looking to confirm. No, that's like, no wonder you couldn't remember them. Okay, well, thank you very much for your evidence today. I think we've got a pretty open mind on this committee, and certainly in this bill, so we'll see where it takes us with the evidence that we're going to be taking in future sessions, the next one being next Tuesday. So thank you very much for your time, and that ends the public session and indeed the committee deliberations today. So I now close the meeting. Thank you all.